Carl's mom's brother was a brother named Wilbur Smith. And I knew Wilbur years ago. And I was in Grand Rapids at the Becker Bookstore just 2 weeks ago. And they have a large used book section. And, of course, when a guy like me goes to the bookstore, you don't go to look at the new books. You go look at the old ones. And I bought a couple of books at the old bookstore. And I was looking at different books. And I don't know, maybe four or five that I looked at had Wilbur Smith stamped on the end of them. Well, that was, I said, I knew Wilbur, you know, and come to find out, I didn't know that it was Carl's uncle, but come to find out yesterday that maybe Friday, when I was talking to him, they mentioned that she was the sister of Wilbur Smith. So it's a small world. You know, I go out and buy some of Wilbur's books, and then a sister goes to be with the Lord, and her nephew is our song leader. So that's where that goes. Ashtabula, Ohio is I don't know if you know where that's at, but if you go to Cleveland and go around the lake up past, there's Erie, and then way up to the end of Ohio, almost to New York, is Ashtabula. And it's in that rust belt over there around Lake Erie. But the church there in Ashtabula is an old church. Brother David Adams, the pastor there, and he's been a grace pastor for many, many years. I was in his home one time years ago back in the 80s and preaching a meeting there, and his son, about 8, 9 years old, and we were sitting in the living room. I was just meeting him for the first time, and his name was Paul. I said, Paul, what would you like to be when you grow up? And he didn't blink, didn't bat an eye, didn't hesitate. He said, a missionary on furlough. That was what I thought. A missionary, he'd been there as a pastor's in a pastor's home long enough to see enough missionaries come through, and missionaries get treated like divine royalty, you know. And so he'd seen that, and he thought, the thing I want to be when I grow up is a missionary on furlough. And I've remembered that all through those years, because I mean he's a grown man now, but it is interesting that a child gets a perspective of things often as they really are, and adults don't always see it. I wanted to remind you about that. Two is the Bible conference coming up on the 13th of July. Can you believe it'll be July tomorrow? It's the last day of June. Seems to me like it just finished being May. So I'm not real sure where the month has gone. But I'll be in Detroit Tuesday and Wednesday this week. We'll have meetings here Wednesday night. Next Sunday, we'll have our normal meetings here. And then the next week, we'll have a midweek meeting, and then the Bible conference is on us. So it's just really 2 weeks away. And for those of you that are going to, if any of those that are here want to stay at the hotel, be sure and see Debbie about making a reservation at the hotel, because we're filling up our rooms there. And you're certainly welcome to come and stay there or commute back and forth. But it's always nice to be able to stay at the hotel, because you can get involved in those all-night Bible studies that last all night, and then you don't have to, you know, shrink on your way home and that kind of stuff. There's always somebody, some group of guys sitting around studying, and daytime's not enough. You got to do it all night too, you know. So by the fourth day, Bible conference like youth camp. I learned years ago back in the 70s running youth camps that what you did at youth camp is the first evening when you start, that night you keep everybody up all night long. They're all juiced, excited to be there, so you just run them, you work them, you have all of your snipe hunts and everything that night, you know. I used to have this wonderful little tape recording of coyotes baying at the moon, and they start off with this high, and then in about 15 minutes, there's 30 of them going. As we'd keep kids up and keep them up and keep them up and doing stuff, and then tell them a couple of, you know, ghost stories, then put them in the bed. Now, I know you're not supposed to do this at Bible camp, but you tell them Holy Ghost stories. And then I'd put that thing out under the tree out between the boys' cabins, and I had about a 15-minute leader on the little cassette tape back in those days, you know. So then all of a sudden that thing would start, and these little guys, you know, they'd listening, you know. And then in a minute, there's a few more, and pretty soon they're really going, you know. And by 3 o'clock in the morning, you couldn't get those kids out of the rafters. You know, they're So then the next day, they kind of calm down a little bit. And the next night, you have a normal night. And then the next day, you work them hard. The next night, they can't get up in the morning. So that's what you do at, my wife's looking at, well, that's what you do at youth camp. You remember that. And she's giving me these high signs back there. You know, you. When your wife starts doing that, the first thing you wonder is, did I leave my zipper down? I'm sorry, that's the first thing you think about. But anyway, there was a point to that story, but I can't remember what it is now because she got me confused. But the conference will be here in a week or so, and like I said, it was the all-night Bible studies. And there are a few of them. Us guys that are getting a little older, we can't take them all night. You know, we up there at Trinity years ago, we used to stay up all night up there in that meeting room and talk and get up the next day and go like we didn't miss a night's sleep. Now I can stay up till about 2 o'clock and I got to get in bed because if I don't get at least 3 or 4 hours of beauty sleep, you know, I'm really in tough shape. So, all right, 1 Timothy, we're not going to sing tonight. David was playing the piano, but he went in to run the media room. So you folks that are on the internet, you can be thankful for David for doing that because our normal crew is on vacation this week, being the 4th of July. Bob actually was flying to China this afternoon. So Carl is with his mom's passing. She's with his family. He's the one that's usually in China. But Brother Bob DiCarlo, who actually oversees the sound room, the media room, he's leaving. His daughter, Lauren, she just graduated high school, had a big shindig for her yesterday. And then Bob got gout in his foot, so he was hobbling around like he had his, you know, foot broke. And he went to the doctor, and they call it gout. I guess that's what, you know, if you make enough money, they call it gout. If you're down in medium, normal people call it rheumatism and that kind of stuff. And if you're poor, you just say you stumped your toe. But, you know, it's different levels of because what it is it's all treated exactly the same way. But Bob's in the air by now going to China. So anyway, we shorthanded in there, so David was going to do that. And Dawn isn't here to play, and he's not going to be able to play, and we got 3 other piano players. None of them are available, and I'm certainly not going to lead the singing. So I'd let Mike lead the singing, but I've heard him sing too. Mike's the kind of guy that makes me feel good when it comes to singing. So, all right, 1 Timothy chapter 1. I think that was everything. They did tell me there was something up here that I was supposed to read to you, but I did that thing about the reminder about the activities on the book table and stuff that are out there. So I don't remember. There was something that somebody told me, but they'll have to come and remind me. Good evening. Well, a song leader came in, but now we still don't have a piano player. Yeah, you did. Yeah. Timed that just right. We've given up. 1 Timothy chapter number 1. Well, let's see. I can turn this thing on. All right, 1 Timothy chapter number 1. Now, we're going to continue kind of introducing the book here this evening. It's what happens here in verse 1, 2, and 3. He says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God our Savior and the Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope, unto Timothy, our son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. As I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine. You notice how he says in verse 1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God. In other places, you say by the will of God. But here he's talking about it's not just by God's will, it's not just by an appointment. This is a commandment of God. If you look over in Titus chapter 1, he says in Titus 1, Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect and the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness. That's the purpose of what his apostleship is going to accomplish. In hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began, but hath in due times manifested his word through preaching, which is committed unto me according to the commandment of God our Savior. Just like God gave the commandments to Moses to give to Israel, he's given commandments to us. He gave commandments to Paul to give to us. And Paul's apostleship was made an apostle, not just by the will of God, not just by the desire of God, but by the commandment of God. And I've often said in that connection that there is a commandment. Everybody wants to keep the commandments. There is a commandment everybody ought to keep. Because if you kept the commandment that Paul's apostleship was given to you by the commandment of God, and Titus 1:3 says he hath in due times manifested his word through preaching, things that he kept secret prior to Paul, he's manifested that word through the preaching committed unto Paul. That's the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. And it was committed to Paul according to the commandment of God our Savior. Paul said, I speak to you Gentiles inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles. That's not an office he took unto himself. That's an office that God, by his commanding authority, committed to the apostle Paul. And it's important to recognize that. And one of the things you notice when in an introduction to an epistle like this is Paul will set out at the beginning the issues that he's going to deal with. And when you see him start out by saying, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the commandment of God, our Savior, and the Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope, you see him asserting right off the bat, WAP, my apostleship is according to the commandment of God. In other words, he's establishing and laying out and putting forth his apostolic authority as an issue. And the reason for that is you're going to see that that becomes something that is being challenged. Verse number 3, he says, charge some that they teach no other doctrine, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which minister questions rather than godly edifying, which is in faith. So do. Now, the end of the commandment is charity. You do what I'm telling you. Notice what he charged Timothy with is a commandment. Paul is given an apostleship by the commandment of God to go out and give commandments to other people. Commandments of who? The commandments of God. The end of the commandment is charity out of a pure heart and a good conscience and faith unfeigned, from which some having swerved have turned aside into vain janglings, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm. Notice these are not people who are denying the faith in the sense that they're saying Jesus Christ isn't God, or the Bible isn't the Word of God, or that there is no God. They are teaching the Bible. They're upholding the Scripture. They've turned away from Paul's apostleship and turned unto the law. The law is Scripture. The law is the commandment of God through Moses to the nation Israel, desiring to be teachers of the law. Paul said they don't understand what they are saying, nor where they got no idea what they're doing. They don't understand what they're saying. They don't understand the load and the burden that puts them under. So what's happening is that some people at Ephesus have departed from the faith. The way they departed is, excuse me, they're scriptural. They're using the Bible, but they're not dispensational. They're following the Bible. The laws is a God-given system in the Bible, but they're not rightly dividing the Bible. That's why when you get to 2 Timothy, this thing in chapter 1, verse 6, when he says, from which some, having swerved, that is, from faith and a good conscience, having turned aside into vain jagglings, desiring to be teachers of the law, some people there were departing the dispensational truth and the word rightly divided back into going back into Israel's program. Now watch in 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 13, hold fast the form of sound words. Get a grip on this stuff, Paul. Get a grip on the sound doctrine, which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus, that good thing which was committed unto thee, that deposit of truth that you got from me, keep. That word keep is like guard it, protect it, by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. This thou knowest, that all they which are in Asia be turned away from me. Now, back in 1 Timothy, it was some. Now it's all. Notice they turned away from Paul. They've turned away from his message, his authority. That's what they would do it in 1 Timothy. They were desiring to be teachers of the law. And what's happened is they've become the most dangerous thing you can be. The most dangerous doctrine you can teach is not just to throw the Bible out, because the Bible can defend itself. Truth will out. The most dangerous thing is not just to teach to mix the Bible with tradition and religion. Those are bad things, but they're not the most dangerous thing. Because if you don't believe the Bible, you throw the Bible out, don't use it at all. Listen, you can still come along. I've seen it happen for 50 years. You can come along with the Word of God and talk to somebody that tells you, I don't believe it, and just keep using it. And you know what it'll do? It'll do its work. I have friends who are in the ministry today that got saved starting out with the person that witnessed to them. I've won some of them to Christ who they'd start out saying, I don't believe the Bible. And you just say, well, that's interesting, but did you know that it says? And you just keep using it, and it will bring conviction. You take somebody who adds tradition to it. Jesus says you make the Word of God of none effect by your traditions and so forth. And that's a bad thing. But you know what the Bible can do to tradition? It can still cut through it. The most dangerous thing, those are bad things, don't misunderstand me, they're dangerous. But the most dangerous thing is to use the Bible and believe the Bible, but to refuse to rightly divide the Bible. Because now you're making the Bible your authority, not tradition, not human viewpoint. But you're not rightly dividing the Word of truth. And the consequence of that is that you teach error that binds you and that completely blinds you. So to be scriptural but not dispensational is far more dangerous than any of the other things that you can get involved in. The other things aren't good. They're bad. They're dangerous. But the most dangerous thing is to be scriptural but not dispensational, to use the Bible but don't rightly divide the Bible. And that's where things have developed to in 2 Timothy. And they've departed from God's word rightly divided. They've departed from Paul, who by the commandment of God is our apostle and will be their apostle. And they've gone back making like there's no difference in it. If you go to chapter 2 of 2 Timothy, that's the reason he says the things he does there in verse 14. Of these things, put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they, notice, charging them, commanding them, that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. But shun profane and vain babblings. Now, you know, preachers are taught to be nice and sweet. Paul was, I mean, he was a nice and sweet guy, but sometimes he was like an old corn cob. He'd just rub you raw. And he says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, right to dividing the word of truth, but shun profane and vain babblings. What do you reckon that is? Well, if he said right to divide the word so that you wouldn't be ashamed because you didn't, and then he says shun profane and vain babblings, whatever the profane and vain babblings are, they have to do with God's word that is not rightly divided. You follow that? When you don't rightly divide the word, what you wind up teaching is vain and profane. Those two words, profane. What is profanity? Well, you know, you usually think of it as cursing. We talk about it being vulgar. Used to be, people called it vulgar when they cursed. Come around my house, it still is. My wife is very righteous about those things. She chews me out constantly about the television. I say, I'm not even listening to it. Well, turn it off. Fine, I turn it off, and then she'll come on, turn it back on, because you like the noise in the house. When you raise three kids, you know, and then you got grandkids, you like noise in the house. And when nobody's there but her and I, and I'm not making any noise much, And you turn the TV on. But now it's got where the TV curses and carries on so bad that, but we call that vulgar. Well, those terms, vulgar, that just means common. Profane, it means common. It means things that are just, it comes to mean just gutter talk kind of thing. He's saying that when the Word of God isn't rightly divided, you know what you're doing? You're just using gutter talk. Now, he's not saying that you're cussing with four-letter, well, you, sometimes you do use four-letter words, but, you know, L-O-V-E is a four-letter word, so you have to be careful about that kind of, but I'm talking about bad words kind of thing. There's a preacher going around, she's got a book out about the Christian F word. And, you know, you, when you hear that, you think, what's that? Well, he's talking about forgiveness. But you can sell, titles sell books, and he's selling skedaddles of books because Christians want to know how to use the Christian F word. Well, that's a great title. You know, I wish I'd have thought about that. I could have made a tape and maybe made us enough money to pay the building off or something. But profane and vain, I see what he calls them? Babblings. Babbling's what I'm doing now. You're just talking out of your, you know. A babbling, just talking out of your head, just talking to be talking. Most of what you listen to in religion is just people just talking. Got no sense to it, no rhyme or reason to it. It's just profane, common, worthless, earthy, and vain, empty, no value to it, jabber. Back in 1 Timothy 1, verse 6, I love the way he says this, from which turn, having swerved, that is from the sound doctrine, having turned aside into vain jangling. Well, that's the same thing over here in 2 Timothy 2:16. Profane and vain babbling. I heard a definition years ago, an old country preacher down in Alabama. He said, vain jangling. He said, if you want to know what that is, just think of a truckload of pots and pans getting run over by a truckload of pigs. And if you can think of that racket, that's a vain jangling. Well, that's what jangling is. Vain is useless, empty. And we talk about somebody being an airhead, vanity. Jangling is just the truckload of pigs hitting a truckload of pots and pans. And it means nothing. Useless noise. Well, vain and profane babblings is what happens when you don't write. In other words, you're using the Scripture, but what you're using the Scripture for turns out to be useless talk. For they will increase into more ungodliness, 2 Timothy 2, verse 17, and their word will eat, as doth the canker. It's dangerous to teach God's word when you don't teach it rightly divided. Because when you don't teach God's word rightly divided, you turn it in to something that eats away the heart. It slowly destroys and spreads all over a person. And when something eats, it doth a canker. That is, it's a sore that just spreads and causes misery and destruction. Now, watch Paul give you an illustration of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus. Now, you know, people say, well, preachers shouldn't name names. Well, Paul's naming names. Ooh, you know, he wants to be sure they understand who he's talking about. Who concerning the truth have erred. Now, look how they erred. Saying that the resurrection is past already. Now, what did they do when they did that? That's what right division is about, knowing where to put things on the timeline. And they're saying the dispensation of grace is over with and we're back in Israel's program and we ought to be going by Israel's program, not that stuff Paul was teaching. The resurrection would be the rapture. The dispensation of grace is over with and now we're in the tribulation period. And he says about what they do, and they overthrow the faith of some. Verse 14, he said they subvert the hearers. When you subvert something, you turn it upside down. When you overthrow something, you turn it upside down. You subvert the hearers by overthrowing the faith, and the way you overthrow their faith is not tell them the Bible's not the Word of God, it's just to tell them what the Bible says, but don't rightly divide what the Bible says. To be scriptural but not dispensational is the most dangerous thing you can do. And when you get into these pastoral epistles, you see the progression in Timothy where it's some has become all of them. And that's the reason I said to you earlier that when you look at 1 Timothy, You're going to see him tell Timothy about how to set the local church in order. Here's how it needs to function. Here's what its job is. And Timothy, I left you at Ephesus to get this thing done. When you come to 2 Timothy, a few years later, the apostasy that he had warned Timothy about, he warned the Ephesian elders about it in Acts 20, has now set in. The psalm has become all. And so 2 Timothy, 1 Timothy is the church in rule, 2 Timothy is the church in ruin. And when you get to 2 Timothy, the last epistle Paul wrote, he's facing a complete apostate Christianity. Now, every single individual isn't gone. Timothy's there. There is a faithful remnant. But as far as the church at large is concerned, the body of Christ at large, they had gone into the apostasy of going back and identifying themselves with Israel's program. They hadn't left the faith. They hadn't quit trusting that Christ is God. They hadn't quit trusting that the Bible is the Word of God. They'd simply left God's Word rightly divided. And it took them into error, and it negated them, subverted everything they're doing. So when you get to 2 Timothy, by the way, 2 Timothy is the last epistle Paul wrote. When you start church history, usually when you get a church history book, they will start with the end of the book of Acts or with the beginning, with the end of the New Testament scriptures. You know what the condition Paul says the church is in when he goes off the scene? It's in total apostasy. So if you look at the church fathers, what are called the Ante-Nicene fathers, that is the Council of Nicaea in the 4th century, all the fathers, the church writers, church fathers before that, you know where Paul says they all are? They're in apostasy. So when you read about these guys and you can buy a set of books, about 40 volumes, called the Ante-Nicene Fathers. I've read it. And there's a little interesting thing hither and yon, but the whole crux of it is just trying to be Israel. And it's those guys that led to the weakness of the body of Christ, and it's who led to the bishop at Rome becoming the head of the church and the political structure being built up around it. And by the 4th and 5th century, the whole thing, political apparatus, was just completely gone. And the real church is just out here in little groups like we are. Where do you think we're going to appear in church history? You think Shorewood Bible Church, or Grace School of the Bible, or Grace Impact Ministries, or any of the other churches around the country that we're a part of, us Bible conference, you reckon that's going to show up big in the pages of church history? I don't think so. But if you go downtown and get the archbishop, whatever he is, cardinal's name down there, guy's name, I see his mind, I can't, who is it? The Catholic.
George,
that's it. I'm trying to remember. Thank you. Trying to remember his name. Bernardine was the last one I could remember, and he's dead. But the cardinal down there, will you think he'll be in church history? I think so. Why? Because his crowd writes history. It's Roman Catholics and Protestant sympathizing Catholics, Roman Catholic sympathizing Protestants that wind up writing church history. We won't be, we're here. We have an active, good ministry. We won't appear anywhere. Why? Because the people that write history don't look at us as a significant issue. That's okay. What it tells you is you and I have brethren that go all the way back to the time of Paul, and people say, well, where are you in church history? Right where we are. Someone asked Martin Luther one time, says, where was your faith before? They ask a follower of Martin Luther, where was your faith before Martin Luther? And the guy had a great answer. He says, the same place your face is before you wash it, behind the dirt. I like that guy. I wish I knew him. Well, when you come to 1 Timothy, you're not quite there yet. You're beginning to get there. But he sends Paul to Timothy, is in Macedonia, in Ephesus here, and he's there. He leaves him there in order to try to stem the tide of apostasy. And the way you do that is by establishing the local church in that community in an organized, effective, ministering way. Because the front line of defense against the lie program is a fully, properly functioning local church. That's what the defense against the lie program is designed to be. And so that's what he leaves him there for. And when he says in verse 3, as I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia, that helps you kind of understand something about when the book was written. And just to be a little esoterical with you here for a couple of minutes, come with me to Acts chapter 20 in one hand and 2 Timothy chapter 4. Acts 28 and 2 Timothy chapter number 4. There is a question about when some of these books were written, when 1 Timothy and Titus and Philemon. Philemon was written at the same time as Colossians. It's easy to understand. Colossians and Philippians and Ephesians are called prison epistles. In those books, Paul talks about being in prison. He says, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, to you Gentiles, Ephesians 3:1. He talks about being a prisoner. He talks about being a prisoner and those of Caesar's household in Philippians. And he talks about that in Colossians. He's in prison in Rome. Where he's at is in Acts chapter 28. In Acts 28, verse number 30, Paul abode 2 whole years in his own hired house and received all that came to him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching those things which were concerning the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence, no man forbidding him. So you say, well, Paul is a free man, isn't he? Well, no, he's not. Because if you go back up to verse number 28:16. And when we were come to Rome, the centurion delivered the prisoners to the captain of the guard. But Paul was suffered to dwell by himself with a soldier that kept him. And it came to pass that after 3 days, Paul called the chief of the Jews together. And he said unto them, men and brethren, though I have committed nothing against the people or the customs of our fathers, yet was I delivered prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. So Paul is a prisoner under arrest by the Romans. Verse 19. When the Jews spake against it, I was constrained to appeal unto Caesar, not that I had aught to accuse my nation of. For this cause, therefore, have I called for you, to see you, and to speak unto you, because that for the hope of Israel, watch, I am bound with this chain. So Paul is in prison. He's a prisoner of Rome, bound by a chain to a Roman soldier. And yet he's allowed to live, he's not put in the huskal, he's allowed to live in his own hired house. He's sort of like under house arrest. And this prisoner from back in Acts 26 along in there, Acts 24 when he's before he's before Festus and Agrippa and all that stuff, and he makes the appeal to Caesar. From then on in Acts, he's traveling as a prisoner of Rome, going to Rome to be tried by Caesar. And he's a prisoner. Well, this is when he writes, down in verse 30 and 31, that period of time, that 2 years there, that's when he writes Ephesians and Philippians and Colossians and Philemon, what we call the prison epistles. Now, when it says he's under house arrest, he's in his own hired house. Brother Ray used to go down and work for an outfit down where he would go and put the Martha Stewart bracelets, the ankle bracelets on people, where they could stay at home, but they're still bound at home. Well, that's an electronic chain kind of thing. Well, it was that kind of thing. He's under arrest. He's not free to go. He's got a Roman soldier, but he's not down in the dungeon at that moment. Okay? Now, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 6. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord the righteous judge shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing. Now, in this situation, he's in a different kind of prisoner. This is a different level of being a prisoner. Now he's ready to be executed. At this point in 2 Timothy, he's not in under house arrest where he's in his own hired house. Now he's actually in the Roman prison. Now he's waiting for the time of his departure, his execution. Now, there's people argue about whether the execution date has been set by now or hadn't been set, but Nero is the ruler, the Roman Caesar there, and Paul has been sentenced to death, and he's waiting on it. Now, the question is the condition Paul is in the book of 2 Timothy, with the time of his departure and so forth, he's a prisoner of Rome. Back over here in Acts 28, he's also a prisoner of Rome. But when you read him, you can tell the prison status that he's in is different. In Acts 28, he's in his own hired house. He's allowed to preach and to teach. People can come to him and receive things. He's able to send letters out and receive communication back in. And he has the Jews at Rome come into his house and deals with them. So his status in Acts 28 is markedly different than it is in 2 Timothy. So the question arises, and the fact is that Paul, when he's in prison in Acts 28, subsequent to that time he's there under house arrest, and before he is put into incarceration as in 2 Timothy, there's a time where he has a period of freedom. And it's generally called the two imprisonments. One is at the end of Acts, then he's let go out of that prison, he's released, and then he's re-arrested by Rome, and then at that point he's executed. And the way you know that is by reading some of these things in these pastoral epistles. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 3, when he said, I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus, as I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia. Now, the question is, when did he do that? Well, the only, you know, if you go back to the book of Acts, when was he in Macedonia? And when he was, when could he have said to Timothy, stay in Ephesus, for thee to abide still at Ephesus, while I went into Macedonia? Paul and Timothy are in Ephesus, and he said, I want you to stay here and do the ministry here while I go to Macedonia. And you say, well, when could that be? Well, Acts 20 is when he gathered the Ephesian elders together, but he wasn't at Ephesus. But, you know, you say, well, it could have been then, but it wasn't Acts 20 because Paul in Acts 20 didn't abide at Ephesus. He didn't even go to Ephesus. He stopped at Miletus and called the elders from there. When he left Ephesus, left Miletus, where he met with the Ephesian elders in Acts 20, he didn't go to Macedonia. Where he went was to Jerusalem, and then to Caesarea, and then to Rome. So the timing doesn't fit. When he says there in verse 3, charge them that they teach no other doctrine, obviously the apostasy is there. If you go back to Acts 20, Paul warns about the apostasy. But it isn't there yet. In Acts 20, verse 28, he's talking to the elders of Ephesus. They met him at Miletus. If you go back up to verse 17, from Miletus he sent for to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. And by the way, well, they meet at Miletus, which is over on the coast. So he gets the elders there. And he says to him in verse 28, take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, and shall not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after themselves. Watch therefore and remember. And he goes into... that by a space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. Notice that he tells them two things are going to happen. Grievous wolves, people from outside are going to come in and try to destroy the flock. From within, people are going to try to draw away disciples after themselves. So you've got some coming from out, some coming from in. But they aren't there yet. He's just telling them, when I leave, they're coming. But when you come to 1 Timothy chapter 1, they're already there. He says, Tim, go in there and charge them that they teach no other doctrine. These dudes are already in their midst. So that what he had predicted in Acts 20, but wasn't there yet, now is here. So when you read that, you say, well, wait a minute, this that he's writing here, he didn't write this in Acts 20. Beside that, he didn't leave Timothy at Ephesus in Acts 20 either, by the way. But when you read it, you begin to say, well, wait a minute, that Timothy 1 verse 3 begins to tell me that when this thing must have been, it wasn't back there in the book of Acts. So when was it that he could have possibly gone back to Ephesus and then on to Macedonia? Well, the only time that there is for him to do that is after the book of Acts is over with, because he doesn't do it anywhere in the book of Acts. And this is one of these things that makes you think, well, after Acts is over, then there's a period of time in which Paul had some freedom and he's let go. Look over at 2 Timothy chapter 4. This is one of the verses that kind of ties the rag on the bush. Second Timothy chapter 4, verse 20. Erasmus abode at Corinth, but Trophimus have I left at Miletum sick. So Paul, before he wrote 2 Timothy 4, was traveling with a dude named Trophimus. You'll see him in Acts 21 and actually in Acts 22. He's a companion of Paul, and he left him at Miletum sick. Now, this is the last book Paul wrote. So somewhere just before this, Paul has left him sick. You don't read that, you don't find a place where that fits in the book of Acts. So obviously there's some things that took place in Paul's life after the conclusion of the book of Acts. Now, we can talk about why Acts concluded. You see, the book of Acts was not written to give you a history of Paul's ministry. The book of Acts was written to show you the fall of Israel and salvation going to the Gentiles through Paul's ministry. It was written to show you how God was just in setting aside the nation Israel for their unbelief, how he concluded them all in unbelief, that he might have mercy on them. It was not designed to show you what Paul's doing. It's designed to show you why God was just in setting Israel aside. And so it's not a problem to see that there would be other information that isn't included in the book of Acts, either actually all through Paul's ministry. When you read his epistles, you see all kind of things he's doing that don't even show up in the book of Acts, because that's not the purpose of Acts. You know, everybody says the Acts is the pattern for us. It's not the pattern for anybody today. It's the pattern to show you that what began in the book of Acts was set aside and transitioned away and was replaced by what comes in Paul's epistles. So it's not there's not a problem in understanding something happened after Acts and then it gets included here like this. If you look you look back up at chapter, you're in 2 Timothy 4, look back at chapter at verse number 9 and 10. Do thy diligence to come unto me shortly. He's telling Timothy, who is at Ephesus, I want you to come to Rome and get here quick. So he's summoning Timothy from Ephesus to Rome. But if you go back over to Acts chapter 20, Timothy was already in Rome, Acts 28. Now, how do you know Timothy was in Rome in Acts 28, 30? Well, if you look at Philippians chapter 1, Philippians chapter 1, Paul, Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ. Timothy was with Paul when he wrote Philippians, and he wrote Philippians from Rome. Colossians chapter 1. Paul, a servant, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother. So Timothy is with Paul when he writes these prison epistles from Rome in Acts 28. But when you get over here to 2 Timothy, he's not with him anymore. He says, come, I left you at Ephesus. When did he do that? Well, evidently, there was a time when he was released from Rome, and Timothy accompanied him on a journey back through Macedonia, Ephesus, and so forth. And he left him at Ephesus to carry on the ministry there that we're going to read about in Timothy, to set things in order. Paul goes on to Macedonia. And by the way, hold your hand here and come with me to, hold your hand in 2 Timothy and come with me to Romans 15. Romans chapter 15, verse number 22. 15:22. For which cause I have been much hindered from coming to you, but now, having no more place in these parts, and having a great desire after many years to come unto you, whensoever I take my journey into Spain, I will come to you, for I trust to see you in my journey and to be brought on my way thitherward by you, if first I be somewhat filled with your company. But now I go into Jerusalem to minister to the saints, and if it please God, please them of Macedonia and Achaia to make a certain contribution for the poor saints at Jerusalem. Now, that, we know when that's in Acts 20. But he says, subsequent to that, my intention is to go to Spain. And on my journey to Spain, I'll stop by and see you guys because I've always wanted to see you anyway. Just never made it there. So Paul's got this traveling blood. He wants to reach out to the regions beyond. And the gospel has reached as far as Italy. And now he says the next stage is Spain. In fact, if you wanted to put any stock in church history, church history says that he got as far as the British Isles. Now, when did he do that? Well, if he got to Spain or got on out of around beyond Spain, it wasn't during the Acts period. It would be something that happened after the book of Acts is over with, but Paul's ministry is still going. So the idea is that he's in prison in Acts 28 in a more casual kind of a house arrest situation. Then he's released, and then he's rearrested. But during that period of time of release, anywhere from 2 to 5 years in there, it's estimated. And the way you estimate that is Nero died in 64 A.D. And Nero is supposed to be the one under whose hand Paul was martyred. Now, that's history. You don't know that from the scripture, but you know he's about to die in 2 Timothy 4, and so you know he did die. And so what you do with that is you can kind of date the timing on a calendar. It's very difficult to, you know, somebody say Acts 20 is A.D. so-and-so. I have, you know, almost no way of knowing that for sure. Sometime in one chapter in Acts, it'll be 10 years go by. And it's difficult to put a date, but there's certain historical things. The Herod that was there when Jesus was born, that Herod in history died was it 4 B.C.? Well, if he died in 4 B.C., then you know Christ couldn't have been born in 1 A.D. The calendar's it's kind of screwed up a little bit, see? So when you start dating this stuff, it's real difficult. The best way to do it, really, I guess, is to take something like the birth of Christ, that Herod, find out where he, you know, if you know when he died, you know Jesus had to be born somewhere between then and 2 years prior to that. So on a Roman calendar, you could fix the date. But I don't care what the date was. Frankly, it doesn't bother me because I don't have a prophetic time schedule that I need dates with. Okay? Now, in the book of Acts, I like to be able to say Romans was written in Acts 20. 2 Corinthians was written in Acts 20. 1 Corinthians was written in Acts, 18, 19, and Acts 19. Thessalonians were written. That helps me to say Acts 18, Acts 19, Acts 20. But I can put that there because I can figure out when he was. And I can figure out from these things that after Acts is over, at the end of Acts, he writes Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. And then subsequent to that, he's free again. And in that time period he's freed, after that first imprisonment, before the second one, is when he's doing this stuff we're reading in Timothy and Titus. And then in 2 Timothy, he's back in prison again. And he's and telling them to come. Look at Titus chapter 1. In Titus, again, he's not in prison. Titus chapter 1, verse 4. To Titus, mine own son, after the common faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. By the way, you notice he says grace, mercy, and peace. On all the church epistles, he says grace and peace. In these epistles written to these individuals, he adds that word mercy. And we'll talk some detail about what that is. But the old preacher's joke is that, you know, you need grace and peace to deal with things, but when you have to deal with a local church, you need mercy stuck in there too. And that's a joke, but there is something to notice that's added in, because it is in relationship to the leadership of the ministry that's an issue. But notice he says in verse 5, "For this cause I left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order things which are wanting." Then notice, Paul is in Crete. He leaves Titus in Crete. So he visited Crete with Titus, and then he left Titus to finish the work, and he goes on. Now you say, well, when was that? Well, it's not during the book of Acts. I mean, his first journey to Rome, he viewed Crete from Fair Havens in Acts 27. He's on the boat, and they see it. They don't go ashore. And he didn't have Titus with him then. He had Luke and Aristarchus with him in Acts 27. But he didn't have Titus. So this isn't his journey to Rome, to Jerusalem, rather. This would have to be after he'd gotten to Jerusalem, he's let go and goes visits Crete. He's in Ephesus. He's in Macedonia. He's got Titus with him. He's got Timothy with him. He leaves Timothy here. He puts Titus over there. And so if you look over at chapter 3, Titus 3, verse 12, "When I shall send Artemas unto thee," or Tychicus, "be diligent to come unto me in Nicopolis, for I have determined there to winter. Bring Zenas the lawyer and Apollos on their journey diligently, that nothing be wanting unto them." I mean, he's traveling. And he's got these guys with him. It took considerable time to do all of this. This is not something where he just, you know, went downtown and visited for 3 weeks and they put him back in jail. He's going to winter at Nicopolis. He's obviously free, or expects to be free, in the wintertime. Now, when you look at 2 Timothy 4, he tells Paul, Timothy, he says, do thy diligence to come before winter. He's not free there. Come visit, come see me in Rome. Bring the cloak. Bring my overcoat and the parchments, especially the parchments. Bring the books, the things to write with. Now, that's 2 Timothy 4. But when he writes Titus, he obviously thinks he's going to be free to do these things. So what you've got here is you've got a situation where, if it matters to you, to date Timothy, Titus, and 2 Timothy, they're going to date after the close of the book of Acts, when Paul is released from prison, the house arrest. He makes another series of journeys, anywhere from 2 to 5 years. This would be the time period where, if he went to Spain, this would be when he did. He visited the churches. He went through Macedonia. He was at Ephesus. He's up at Crete, which is out in the sea there. And he's going around all the, and then he's rearrested. You don't have a record of that. But you know what happened, because in 2 Timothy, there he is back in jail, back in chains. And finally, to be arrested, I mean, to be executed. So what you have in Timothy, and the reason this gets important to me in 1 Timothy 1, is the time period. In Acts 20, he tells them at Ephesus, there's an apostasy coming. In 1 Timothy, enough time has developed, passed, for that apostasy to develop. It's not full-fledged like it is in 2 Timothy. And Paul's going to write to Timothy and give him instructions about how to stop, how to hinder, how to put the brakes on that apostasy. And what he's going to tell him to do is how to organize the work of the ministry of a local church, because the frontline defense against the lie program is the truth. The truth program, and that's why 1 Timothy chapter 3 talks about that local church as being the pillar and the ground of the truth. The first line of defense against the lie is not a political system or a political party or a political movement. It's not an education school system or that. It's a fully, properly functioning local assembly of believers led by godly men who are preaching the truth of God's word rightly divided. And that is the only hope of stopping the lie program. All the rest of it gets co-opted. And you have to be very careful that the local church doesn't get co-opted. And that's why Paul's telling them, writes these things out. And if you take that structure in 1 Timothy, that 1 Timothy does, and the way the church in rural is to operate, you'll see how a local geographic manifestation of the body of Christ would function, and see how that it can do just that. And it can be the pillar and the ground of the truth. It can be the end of the commandment is charity, out of a pure heart and of a good conscience and of faith unfeigned. It'll be something of value. Charity, the ability to value and esteem a thing the way God values and esteems a thing. That charity out of a pure heart, out of a soul. Your heart is the mentality of your soul, and it's a single-minded. It's a heart that just goes on sound doctrine. It's not living on emotions. It's not living on religious tradition. It's living on the application of the truth of God's word rightly divided, and of a good conscience. Your conscience is a system of norms and standards that allows you to evaluate what's going on around you. You know, we live in a day when people don't know how to do that. They look at what's going on and they react, but to be able to accurately evaluate and see beyond the fuzz and see what the real issue is, well, that's what a good conscience does. You have a system of norms and standards that reflect God's thinking. And thus you have a faith unfeigned. You're able to walk by faith and not by sight. You know what he's describing there? That's a beautiful description of a mature Christian walk. And not just an individual walking that way, but a group of people gathered together, living together, working together in the work of the ministry, producing that. And when you have that, you have, Paul told the Corinthians, he says, as unknown and yet well known. I love that verse. Because that's exactly what your spiritual power and influence is far outweighed. It far outweighs your appearance. You say, well, there's only a few of you. That don't make any difference. It's not how many. I mean, how many were there on the ark? Well, we got more than that, so we're ahead of Noah. But that's not really the issue. The issue is the truth. And the truth does its work. So the world might say you're unknown, but God says you're well known. And that's what's going on here. And so understanding that gives you the ability when you come to Timothy to know this is not just a bunch of rules and regulations and so forth. This is a description of the front line of defense against the lie program. And if you want to build something for your family and your community that will protect them and give them a basis from which protection can be launched, it's have a good, sound, functioning local church. Now, you'll discover in this thing that a local church is not a building. It's not a constitution. It's a group of saints gathered together who've made a commitment to do the work of ministry God's way. Now, they organize themselves. They've got offices. They've got the office of bishop, office of the deacon. So they have an organization. They have a social compact upon how which they're going to operate. But the local church, even its leaders, Paul writes to Thessalonians, he says, know them that labor among you and are over you in the Lord. You see, it's not oversight. It's not being overlords. It's laboring among you and then taking responsibility to see that that labor works. Well, that godly leadership with godly people involved in a work of ministry, number one, it's the greatest protection you'll ever have for your family, for yourself, but it's a way to have an influence on your community that is real. And as we study 1 Timothy, you'll see the details of that. And it's so vastly different than anything you've ever seen. Well, I shouldn't tell you guys anything you've ever seen, but from most of what we see. There's much of the stuff we'll study in Timothy that I scratch my head and say, you know, there's just not, how would we do that? Things are so screwed up now. I know it's the goal, and I'd love to see it happen, but I scratch my head sometimes and wonder, what would you do? You read that stuff in 1 Timothy 5 about the widows and all that stuff, and you say, wow, that is so different than what. But there are times when the, you know, saints are able to do it, and if that's the goal. But the point isn't to make a standard that I'm condemning myself because I'm not meeting. The point is what that's about is the impact of that local of the body of Christ in a locality doing what the body does, the one anothering, and being the pillar and the ground of the truth. So we'll have a good time when we study 1 Timothy. Father, we thank you tonight for your goodness to us. We thank you for the life that's ours in Christ Jesus and the privilege of not just being saved and enjoying our life in Christ, but of being able to be good workmen that take your truth and allow it to work in the ministry through us, so we can think like you think, desire what you desire, that is to have all men saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. We thank you for that privilege in Christ's name. Amen. All right, thank you. Brother Ben, did y'all get moved?
Yeah.
So you're here letting your wife straighten up the house?